Guru Maharaj, Hare Krishna. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to your lotus feet. Guru Maharaj, Hare Krishna. Guru Maharaj, we have 18 participants as of now. And today's topic is about Srila Prabhupada's vision about ISKCON. Am I correct?
Simple living, but in that direction. Srila Prabhupada's vision for ISKCON, which is his vision on simple living.
Okay, Guru Maharaj, great. Thank you so much. You can take over the call now. Hare Krishna. Yeah,
you can take the. You can put the verse on the board. It's 1:10:4. Okay.
Yes, it is Bhagavad Gita, Guru Maharaj, or?
No, this is Srimad-Bhatavatam, first canto, 10th chapter, verse number 4.
Okay, Guru Maharaj.
Okay, so, Om Agyan Timirandasya Girajana Salakaya Chaksun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Guru Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadam Mayam Dadati Swam Padati Kam Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prastai Bhutale Sri Makti Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pucharine Nirase Sasunya Vahari Vastyatya De Sitarine Panchakalpatu Vischa Kripa Sindhu Ve Vucha Patita Nam Pavane Vyo Vaishnave Vyo Namaha Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasati Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Okay, and so this is the verse here.
Lavanya Mataji, can you please...
Yes, Mataji?
Can you please start sharing because I'm not able to do it here.
Okay, Mataji. Sorry.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. How is Karuna Sindhu? Archana.
Yes, Guru Maharaj. He is good, Guru Maharaj. He has a lot of. he's kind of busy these days, but you know he hears your call when he's in and out. He has a lot of meetings in the morning.
Yeah, well, he's actually going to the office, huh?
No, he's not. He's at home. He works from home, but he has to. I mean, that kind of makes them even more busy because, you know, a lot of meetings.
Okay. Tell him I said Hare Krishna. I was asking.
Yes, Guru Maharaj, I will do that. His obeisances to you, Guru Maharaj.
Okay. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So we want to explore a little bit about Prabhupada's vision for the ISKCON Society. We'll do that in a series of talks over the next few days. And we'll focus a little bit on the fourth principle, or the fourth part of Srila Prabhupada's movement. When we carefully analyze, we understand that Prabhupada's movement more or less focused on four aspects of development. The first one was holy books and holy names. The beginning of our movement was much emphasis on Harinam Sankirtan. Those of you who are familiar with the early Back to Godhead magazines that were put out, there was continuous pages of devotees doing Harinam in different places around the world, at least at that time. There wasn't so many temples, but that was the focus. And there was a lot of Harinam. Every temple did Harinam. Finally, after some time, books started to come into vogue, where some experiences of devotees distributed in literature had such great receptivity that it turned into a focus on how to get this information out to people on the streets. And then Prabhupada, keeping the Harinam Sankirtan going, but then he also considered book distribution as Sankirtan. He considered it the Brihat Madangar, or distributing his transcendental knowledge in the form of these books. And then, of course, there was an explosion that started around the year 1974 and really continued to increase exponentially everywhere around the world, even up to the time of Prabhupada's disappearance. But in he also emphasized part two of his movement was establishing temples around the world. And Prabhupada, compared to any other religious leader worldwide, established more temples than anyone. He established hundreds of temples, preaching centers, schools, restaurants, and various other outlets for preaching Krishna consciousness. But he emphasized deity worship in the most glorious way, and that was Radha Krishna worship, which is considered to be the most serious of all types of worship, in the sense that it requires Brahmins who are highly qualified to do the worship. And there's much risk in committing offenses. But Prabhupada established Radha Krishna temples. And of course, the movement focused mostly on Western Europe and in America at the time, and later on it expanded into India, where now we have hundreds of Radha throughout the world. And that was a big part of Srila Prabhupada's mission, is to give deity worship in a grand way to the devotees all over the world. Radha Krishna, Jagannath Baladev, Subhadra Maharani, Gornitai, and in some cases, Sitaram, Lakshman, Hanuman. Now, these were the deities that were installed all around the world. So that was the second part of Prabhupada's mission, opening temples and in training devotees to do deity puja. The third was the whole process of initiation. Gandhi coined that phrase, Harijan. Harijan means that those who were in the low section of society could also be recognized as an important part of society, giving them credibility and respect. But Prabhupada took that word and took it to the ultimate. And this Harijan was actually the process of giving people second birth, and that was initiation. So we talked about that yesterday in our lecture in detail. So that, then Prabhupada started to initiate devotees all around the world. 1973, and there were so many initiations. And of course, after that, even before that, there were a few, but not a lot. And devotees started to pour into the temples. The temples had 150 devotees in most of the big temples, with regular Sankirtan, full deity worship, what else was going on? That was our main preaching, and of course the temple's programs were fully, you would go to Mangal Arati and the temple would be full, you would come to evening Arati and the temple would be also quite full with devotees. So that was Prabhupada's mission, and he really established that in a strong way. And Prabhupada himself went all around the world personally to establish all these things, giving initiation, giving lectures, opening temples, doing fire sacrifices, arranging for marriages, opening schools, writing books, translating. What Prabhupada did, he did in a tireless way. He was like, he didn't stop. A couple hours at night sleeping, some little rest during the day, but he was a ball of spiritual energy that was just sweeping all of us up into his, into the tailwind that he created. The devotees were just amazed to see how Prabhupada was going, and many devotees couldn't keep up with Prabhupada. It was just amazing. But Prabhupada just wanted to establish Krishna consciousness in a big way, knowing he didn't have much time left. And so he showed some really, what we say, mystical power in spreading Krishna consciousness. What he did, and if it's accounted in detail, is never been foredone before. How much he did and how fast he traveled is unbelievable for a person who was in his 70s and whose health was always something that was a factor in dealing with his travel. Baba was amazing. But then towards 1974, he started to also point in another direction. He wanted to establish Vanashram Dharma. But then again, he understood that in today's society, Vanashram Dharma cannot be established because people are so mixed up that no one is qualified. And so therefore, understanding that the futility to try to establish Vanashram Dharma in society, he wanted to establish it in a particular setting, calling it Daivi Vanashram, in other words, spiritual Vanashram. He commented, why are so many devotees leaving our movement if chanting Hare Krishna is so powerful and so merciful? Because devotees are not being engaged properly. He said the cities, they are not meant for living. He said cities means simply sense gratification and economic development. Where our future of our movement is, and he was talking about the future, but he was also talking about establishing the principles of the future at the present time, was in the farm communities. So Prabhupada said, we have two very solid programs, book distribution and farm communities. What did he mean by solid? He meant that when you put energy into these particular programs, you get results. You get tangible results. So in 1974, and again every year after, he kept emphasizing the importance of establishing farm communities. Of course, we had the new Vrindavan farm. Gita Nagari was there. Prabhupada loved Gita Nagari. When Prabhupada was sick in 1977, when he was about to leave his body, he decided to make a last-ditch effort to establish Vanashram himself. So in September, just a few months before he departed the world, he got a little better in his health, got on a plane from Delhi and flew to London. And there, his health was quite precarious. He was wearing dark glasses, even inside, and his health was really, really fragile. But his plan was to leave London and go to Gita Nagar, and he said, I want to show how to establish this farm community, Vanashram Dharma, personally. I will show them how to do it. But his health got so bad that he wasn't able to travel anymore, so he was forced to return to Vrindavan. And of course, then we know only about a month and a half later, he departed the world. But this was Prabhupada's, what we say, the unfulfilled mission, and he talks about it all the time. He says, 50% of my mission has been unfulfilled. And he said, we have to establish these farm communities as the future, not only for us, but for the world in general. And I'll read some quotes before we get into the verse. I'll read a particular quote. Let me see if I can get to it from where I am. Seems like I'm stuck here. How do I get to it? He said, let me see if I can. How do I get out of the share screening and into my...
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. Guru Maharaj, I think you are on full screen mode. If you click on escape, you'll be going into a normal window where you can...
All right, we got it. Thank you very much. That worked good. Okay, I'll read some statements by Srila Prabhupada. And he says in this one thing here, he said, civilization will collapse very soon all over the world. It will collapse. Either you bring this ism or that ism, this civilization will collapse. People will become mad being harassed in so many ways. When one is harassed in with so many ways, he commits suicide. So that position is coming soon. And Harikesh Maharaj says, or they start a war. Yes, Prabhupada agreed. When the government cannot adjust, they start a war. It's the old Machiavellian theory where if you have social unrest, you create an external enemy and that unites the country and stops the social unrest and brings gain to economics within the country. So war is always seen as a way to suppress social unrest in a way that is not, that everybody go along with, create the external enemy and unite everybody around that. So Prabhupada is saying his civilization will collapse, and what we're seeing today is some certain signs of that upcoming collapse. This worldwide pestilence is not going away. In fact, it's only getting worse because people don't know how to live. I'll go back to the main verse here. Let me see if I can get back to the verse here. Okay, so now we'll read the verse. Kaman vavarsa parjanya sarvakama dukha mahi. Sisi chu sma prajam galvam paso so da swatir mudam. In translation, during the reign of Maharaj Yudhisthira, the cloud showered all the water that people needed, and the earth produced all the necessities of man in profusion. Due to its fatty milk bag and cheerful attitude, the cow used to moisten the grazing ground with milk. Purport. I'm going to read part of the purport, not all of it. The basic principle of economic development is centered on land and cows. So if you have land, you have something, you have some equity. If you live in a city and you have a house and you own the house or you're paying on the house, that could collapse at any time because everything is dependent on electricity, water, heat, and everything else supplied by the, what we say, the society in general. So that's always very precarious. And cows, the necessity of human life are food, grains, fruits, milks, minerals, clothing, wood, etc. One requires all these things to fulfill the material needs of the body. Certainly, one does not require flesh or fish or iron tools and machinery. During the regime of Maharaj Yudhisthira, all over the world, there were regulated rainfalls rainfalls are not in the control of the human being. So I'll speak about that in detail tomorrow. Well, I'll describe one particular story in my own personal life, how that connects. The heavenly king Indra, Dave, is the controller of the rains, and he is the servant of the Lord. When the Lord is obeyed by the king and the people under the king's administration, there are regulated rains from the horizon, and the rains are the causes of varieties of production of the land. Not only do regulated rains help production of grains and fruits, but when they combine with astrological influences, there is ample production of valuable stones and jewels. So I'll stop here and just mention one thing. People in general do not know where all these minerals and gems that are found both in the waters and the oceans and the land come from. They actually come from God. People are really somewhat oblivious to that. And I'll tell you a little story that at a particular astrological influence, and Prabhupada indicates it here, when it rains during that influence, the water that falls on the ocean turns into pearls. And those pearls are later on taken by oysters. And that's why you find that inside the oysters, you find pearls in there. That's why oysters are considered very valuable. Not all oysters, but many. And so pearls are produced at that particular time. When that same rain falls on the head of a serpent, it produces gems. So we find that due to the arrangement of the Lord at a certain particular astrological influence, these things actually appear. So these, in other words, they're all produced by God, not by man. And they just don't appear within the soil or within the water somehow just because that is the nature of the soil. These things come by the arrangement of the Lord directly. And when there are rulers who are pious, not even what we say spiritually adept, but at least pious, and then there's regular rainfall, we see, as it's described in the scriptures, when nature is working according to the will of God. Of course, nature always works to the will of God, but when it's working to the, what we say, the when the population of the world is pious and following the laws of God, then nature produces everything that is needed in abundance and according to the seasons. For example, what was I going to say? Rainfall. Yes, rainfall. So now it rains helter-skelter. In other words, it'll rain at any time, at any part of the day, in any season. This is due to the inordinate activities of the population at hand, therefore disturbs the natural balance of nature. But when everything works nicely, and this is described in the Shastras, it rains only in the evening. And then it will rain throughout the night. And then when the sun comes out the next morning, the grounds are wet and the sun nourishes the soil and crops and flowers, trees, all of nature gets the benefit of this combination of rain and sunshine. So it's all done according to the will of God in such a way that it works to create harmony and not disharmony. Just like it could rain anytime, it could snow anytime. I've seen even snow in the month of May in Western countries. So yeah, everything is so disordered now because people in the world are not pious. The impious lives of the general population disturb the natural balance that God has created. And when that imbalance balance becomes severe, and then there is crisis, such as pestilence, wars, calamities, fires, various types of difficulties come. And this is all nature's reactions to the sinful activities of the world. And so Prabhupada understood that as society goes on, there will be more and more problems. And then he said, therefore, for our Krishna conscious movement, we should establish these farm communities. Simple living, Krishna consciousness, this is the basis. Produce your own food, work a few months of the year, as Prabhupada goes on to explain. You only have to work 3 to 4 months a year. And then after that, you can, during those 3 and 4 months, you plant for a couple months and you harvest for a couple months. And so everything is given like that. But now people in general are so much attached to this, what we say, convenient modern living, where they have all kinds of electronic gadgets. But Prabhupada said, what is the use of all this stuff? Has it produced, what is the need of artificial luxuries of life like cinemas, cars, radio, flesh, hotels? Has this civilization produced anything but quarrel individually and nationally? Has this civilization enhanced the cause of equality and fraternity by sending thousands of men into the hellish factory and the war fields at the whim of a particular man? So factories, this is another form of hellish existence. People work in factories, which are very harsh environments, struggling in a very depressive environment just to make a little bit of money so they can enjoy sense gratification. So with this particular society we live in, and it's proliferating itself all around the world, is sapping the natural energy, vitality, happiness of the people in general, and everything is focused on sense gratification and economic development. It is said here that the cows used to moisten the pasture land with milk because the milk bags were fatty and the animals were joyful. Do they not require therefore proper protection for a joyful life? They being fed with sufficient quantities of grass in the field? Why should men kill cows for their selfish purposes? Why should men not be satisfied with grains, fruits, and milk, which combined together can produce hundreds and thousands of palatable dishes? Why are there slaughterhouses all over the world to kill innocent animals? Sometimes we say to people who eat meat, okay, you want to eat meat? Well, then why don't you find out how your meat is produced? Take an opportunity and go visit a slaughterhouse and see what happens in there. And then come back and then sit and decide whether you want to continue to eat meat or not. Because meat eating requires violence on innocent animals, and especially the cow. They focus on the cow. The cow is something special. The latest periodical, which was put out by His Holiness Krishna Kshetra Maharaj, really describes the glories of cow within the Vedic society and the cow in general and how it benefits men, not only spiritually, aesthetically, morally, and what we say naturally. The cow, when it walks on the fields, its hooves actually create in the soil to become what we say ready for planting. The cow itself gives milk. Milk can be changed into ghee. Ghee is so tasty, can be used to cook so many different types of tasty foods. The milk is meant to develop the higher brain tissues, which are necessary for understanding spiritual topics. People don't know that when one glass of hot milk a day, 8 ounces, you might say, is enough for the whole day to nourish the brain tissues, where one can start to become more adept at understanding transcendental and philosophical knowledge. Well, milk is a miracle food. And of course, you can take the, not only does the cow give milk, it fertilizes the field with its cow dung. Cow dung has all medicinal properties in it. And this cow dung, they take, even now today in modern medicine, they take cow dung and they use some of the nutrients of cow dung to put into medicines for various treatments. So cow dung is considered pure. In our farm in Belgaum, in Karnataka, in India, South India, well, we have a really developed society of cow protection where they use the cow not only for the basic things such as cultivating the field, getting milky, but they create cow products. When I was there, I saw something which was quite interesting. I saw where they had two pots, and in each pot there was cow dung and cow urine, and then they had two electrical leads coming out of the pot connected to a clock. Now those leads were connected to cow dung and cow urine, and the clock was moving. In other words, there was enough electrical energy inside of cow dung and cow urine combined to actually make a clock move. You could keep time. And this was something I saw personally, so it's not something I just heard. This is just to illustrate some of the glories of the cow. Of course, we have cow dung soap, cow dung toothpaste, cow dung creams, gels, shampoo. The devotees in Belgaum create over 40 items connected to the cow that can be used for one's personal use. A cow is sacred, and of course, what to speak about its spiritual benefit, its milk, its produced ghee, yogurt, and this is called, we have a thing called Panchamrita, the Panchagavya. There's Panchamrita and there's Panchagavya. Panchagavya is the five substances from the cow, and that is cow dung, cow urine, milk, yogurt, and ghee. And we use that for worship in our temples. We bathe the deities with cow dung, cow urine, and these other three substances all coming from the cow. And that is a form of worship. So the cow is also very much used in the worship. And then again, we have the other side, and that is the bull. Now, people can't see any use, even for devotees, they find it difficult to find uses for the bull. But actually the bull is very useful. And because modern day society has replaced the bull with what is called tractors. And these tractors, because they can't find any use for the bull anymore, they kill the bull because they have tractors. As Prabhupada writes here, this is a statement by Prabhupada, this tractor is the downfall of the Indian village system. Because you're eating the bulls, therefore you require a tractor. Otherwise, you don't kill the bulls. This animal will do the business of tractor. Machines means unemployment for many. Tractor, they're using their unemployment for bulls and plowmen, and then the bulls have to be killed. This is going on. Unemployment, then kill them, then send all the men to the war fronts. As soon as there's overpopulation, they declare war so that many people are killed. So the bull is also a cow. It's just a male cow. And it can work very hard and for cultivating the fields. And it also provides many other benefits. Prabhupada writes here one letter to one devotee, Tulsi Das. Your letter is very encouraging. I'm very pleased. If our farm projects are all organized over the world, then we shall conquer. As soon as I see the farms growing fresh vegetables, fruits, and devotees eating sumptuously and chanting Hare Krishna, oh, how wonderful it is. What is this nonsense civilization of the Karmis? When I hear this report, my chest swells up, being so proud of my disciples' achievement. At this point, I said to His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada, you are the Farmacharya. And Prabhupada replied, Krishna is the Farmacharya. Balaram has the plow and Krishna has a calf. So yeah, Krishna is the Farmacharya and Balaram is his assistant. So we worship Krishna Balaram and they stand for simple living Krishna consciousness. Yeah. So back to this one point here that the bulls are being disposed of and killed just and replaced by tractors. And the tractor costs a lot of money to operate. If it gets broken down, it costs more money then. And you have to go out and work to maintain your tractor. You have to work to keep the bull working, but you don't have to worry about repairing the bull. You know. So we have a society that is somewhat dysfunctional. And therefore, Prabhupada's vision, and he made it very clear, that unless we establish these farm communities, we will not be able to continue to propagate Krishna consciousness, because as the society falls apart, people will be looking for a lifestyle that is conducive. And right now we're seeing our normal materialistic lifestyle being squeezed and pushed into a very limited form at the present situation. And these are indications of how society is actually crumbling. And of course, without giving a long list of news reports that are going on around the world, we can see that there's no solution. They don't have any solution for the problems of the world. And people are simply continuing to live in a sinful and what we say ungodly way. But you can't do that, Prabhupada says. Many times throughout the scripture, nature is the servant of God. And if people are too sinful, nature will punish them continuously through wars, pestilence, scarcities, and various other forms of calamities. So these reactions are simply due to the sinful life of the present world population. But Prabhupada he actually predicted this when he was here, which was 50 years ago. He actually predicted how the society would fall, and at the same time, he was also predicting that we as devotees need to move into the direction of these farm communities. He said the cities, we can still be in the cities for preaching because people live there, but for living, it'll only be more in an environment which is natural, which is more healthier. And so we see within our society, there are a few communities that are focusing on developing Prabhupada's vision, but we need more. And so devotees should also think, how am I going to live my life if things start to get worse and worse? Prabhupada also said, this whole society will collapse and therefore the economics will be in a different position. What we see is, as money will be quite useless or maybe even worthless. So if we continue to depend on materialistic civilization in order to provide what we need to live normally, naturally, or spiritually, we will be in a helpless situation. So Prabhupada's vision is not something that is some idea. It's actually the reality, and it's coming from Krishna himself. Krishna is giving us the word that this is the direction that the world has to go in, especially the devotees have to be the leaders and showing how to live as more or less a natural type of lifestyle. I'm presently staying in one apartment in Slovenia, and to get proper ventilation and air, it's really a chore. It's so cold outside, but at the same time, we need fresh air from time to time. So living more in the natural environment, one's health is more or less supported by the environment. Here, the environment challenges your health in so many different ways. Okay, so there are so many reasons, but the real reason is the future of our Krishna consciousness movement really depends on moving our lifestyle. There is living and there is loving. We have to live in such a way that we can love in the right way. Living means the needs that we need, the environment we need, the relationships we need in order to establish our lifestyle. And loving means to have the opportunity and free from the harassment of material energy to develop our love for Krishna. So those devotees who are already living in these environments can really speak. And for everyone, it may not always be possible to make this transfer to a more simple lifestyle, but we might be forced to do it due to the world situation. And from the way things are going, to depend on this situation, world situation now to provide everything we need, maybe is a kind of a risky business. And Prabhupada gives so many reasons. On a personal level, while this lifestyle that Krishna lived was more natural, it doesn't mean you can't have amenities or even luxuries, but when we have to depend on a society that is quite sinful and at any time could collapse, or if it doesn't collapse, what it does, it just increases everybody's taxes, and they keep taking more and more and more and more of the earned money of the population. Those of you who are workers, you know how much of your paycheck is given to other sources. And that will only increase because the governments will start to collapse and they'll just tax the people more and more and more. This is in the Bhagavatam itself. Okay, I don't want to be a doomsday prophet. That's not my position. But I'm trying to emphasize what Prabhupada gave us. And we'll speak a little bit more about it tomorrow in detail. We just did a little skimming of some of the essential points today. So we'll stop here because of our time constraint. And we'll open it up for some questions or comments.
Guru Maharaj, thank you so much for talking about simple living today and the importance of farm communities. Devotees, if you have any questions or any realizations, please share. Unmute yourself and share. Hare Krishna. There is a question on the chat, Guru Maharaj. Can we do that first?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Bhakta Roberto is saying, Hare Krishna, dear Maharaj, how and why earthquake come about according to the scriptures?
These turmoils can be, according to scripture, it is also due to sinful activities of the population. These are similar reactions. Mother Earth is an organism. And when people throw their sins onto Mother Earth, because in the Bhagavatam it explains, Mother Earth can bear a lot of sinful activities, but when people become liars and cheaters, then that creates a great burden on the earth. So these natural catastrophes are simply principles of purifying the world, purifying the earth, and purifying the living entities within the earth. Purifying means destroying some living entities who are too sinful, getting rid of them because of their sinful life, and causing others to change their direction in life. So earthquakes are part of Mother Earth's way of addressing what we say purification. Just like this coronavirus also too, you see that some of the cities, I remember when this coronavirus first came, cities like Delhi and what's the capital of the Philippines? Manila, Delhi, those were the, in other cities, were so polluted. When I was in Delhi at the beginning of the year, this year, I was staying with one very nice family who had a young girl who was school age. She was about 15, she was going to school. And when I was there, it was the middle of the week and it was school days. And so she was home and I asked her, why are you home? She said, well, they call school off for 2 days because the pollution is so bad that if people go out, they get sick. And this was a reality. I experienced that just going out. I felt irritation in my throat just by breathing the air. So we have really devastated Mother Earth with our modern civilization and all our development. But the first couple of months forced everyone to slow down and practically stop in many areas. And the reports were that from Delhi, then they could see the Himalayas again before they couldn't see it. And they were also describing from other cities how much the pure air has returned to the earth again. So Mother Earth has a way of regenerating herself. She is a living entity and she works under the direction of the Lord. So these calamities which happen all over the world are reactions to sinful activities generally, inordinate living style, killing of innocent animals. So according to Shastra, calamities are due to the sinful activities of the population. I could be more specific, but I don't want to go into any personal thing right now, but when we get right down to it, you can evaluate.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
Dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Your Holiness. Thank you for emphasizing the importance of making this transition on this topic of sinful reactions. You know, we are suffering so much because of the sinful reactions. How is it that God, Krishna, who has given so many different religious paths to reach Him, how is it that people practicing so many or claiming to practice these other religions, they don't see meat eating as sinful, they don't see their activities as sinful? How is it that their scriptures are not telling them what is the right thing?
Well, there's many serious practitioners in every religion.
I've had the deacon of a church tell me that, I don't know why you're making such a fuss about meat eating. If I respect the chicken, if I treat it well all its life, and at the end, I decide to take away its life, having treated it with respect, what is wrong with that?
I can do the same thing to you. I can treat you with respect, and then when you get old, I'll just kill you. That's the argument.
I'm just amazed. How is it that they claim to be practicing religion when they can talk like this about, you know, God's creatures?
I can't speak for anyone else, but we understand from our scripture what is the compassionate nature of the human being. Compassionate nature is not to cause harm to any living being, either through the body, mind, or words. That is the principle of civility. That is the principle of the living and the human being's nature. To cause suffering to others is not part of the living being's nature. We are called paropaka. We're meant to give other people benefit in life and not suffering in life. So when things get turned around, people lose the values and the principles, the qualities, the compassionate nature. And this is all due to the civilization we live in, where money, position, power, fame is glorified as success. People do not glorify persons who are worshiping God. And those who worship God, a lot of times they are not completely clear on what are the principles. Therefore, when you want to go for real religious principles, you have to study the Vedas. As Prabhupada quoted one Chinese man, this Chinese man said, if you want to understand what real religion is, go to India. Of course, that was many years ago. Now India has decided to give up its culture and give up its spiritual foundation and become enamored and take to the ways of the West. This is a feature of this particular age. Therefore, education is required.
Yes, Guru Maharaj, we can only pray for people who quote their own scriptures saying, but God said to eat fish and God said to do this and God said to do that. We cannot say anything at this point. It is their scriptures, or at least their interpretation of their own scriptures. What can we do?
Even in the Hindu scriptures or Vedic scriptures, there are statements that kind of indicate that Lord Ramachandra ate meat. As one protagonist, spiritual protagonist, would say that Lord Ramachandra ate meat, therefore we can eat meat too. Or Prabhupada was not so much against meat eating, he was against systematic slaughter of animals. He said, if you want to eat meat, if you have to eat meat, there's two ways you can do it. One, you can wait till the animal dies, and then you can take it and eat meat. Or if you want to do it according to the Vedic method, which is called mamsa, and then he said not the cow, but either the chicken or the sheep, you go and you, on a full moon night, and you chant a mantra into the ear of these animals. And the mantra says, my dear Mr. Sheep Goat, I am killing you so I can eat you. And in the future life, you will kill me and eat me. That's the mantra. It's called Mamsa, M-A-M-S-A. So that is what is called allowing for people who can't give up meat eating to eat, to keep it connected to some religious principle. And when they do that, they can gradually give it up. Well, we are mostly adamantly, strongly against the killing of innocent animals wholesale for economic reasons and for enjoying the so-called enjoyment of eating flesh. So this is where we speak out against the systematic slaughter of animals. Prabhupada, in one lecture in France in 1974, he said, if you want to eat meat, wait till the animal dies and then you can take. But don't kill it. Killing it is sinful. And you'll have to suffer for that also. Next question.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
Yes, a voice to share, prayer goes to you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. I want to mention here in the community in Bangladesh, we have a few projects now to build a new a permaculture. It's called Prema Culture. And we will also learn how to extend and how to grow up the garden and how to learn how to do things in the garden. And then how to be self-sufficient in this sense, and also cow sanctuary. We will build more area. We cut off the trees and we will build more area for the cows. It will be, we also now build the basics for cows. We will do much more now for the self-sufficiency in cow sanctuary and also agriculture here in Radhadesh.
Yeah, this will also bring in a lot of interest from the outside, and that'll help develop the whole project. Yeah, it's good. This is, Prabhupada is very pleased. This is his This is his desired goal, to see our communities develop in this way. So we're looking at a situation where these farm communities were many years before a good idea, but nobody was really doing much on it because we were stuck. And now it appears to be not just a good idea, but a necessity in order for civilization to go on in a more natural and spiritual way. If we can show by example through these communities how to live, this will inspire other people to do the same. But then again, we have to give them the spiritual foundation for everything and not just the material arrangement. So it is great preaching also.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
It's really nice to hear that.
Guru Maharaj, there are successful farm communities and there are unsuccessful farm communities also, ailing old farm communities that have not really picked up. What can we do to turn around these ailing, stagnant farm communities that haven't really picked up?
Follow Prabhupada's instructions on how to do it. Failure doesn't mean that you give up. Failure means you learn by your mistakes, that's all. When you fail at something that you need to do, you just learn what was the cause of failure and try to overwrite that by making the necessary adjustments. And that requires some historical analysis to see. Well, one of the problems is that we did cow protection before agriculture. And agriculture is first. First, you establish agriculture, where you have enough food all year round for the devotees, and then you have enough extra to feed the cows also. As Prabhupada said, what you don't eat, the cows will eat. So agriculture has to be first. So if we put that first and work on to that and include cow protection gradually through that program, then it is more organically done, naturally done. If we just start with cows, and then we'll find it might be very difficult. Of course, you can have one or two cows at the beginning, but a lot of our farm communities that failed just start getting more and more cows without establishing a lifestyle to stabilize both the devotees and the cows. And that starts with agriculture. There's a beautiful compilation of all of Prabhupada's writings that was done by my god sister Hari Krishna Dasi, and then it was reprinted just recently by what's his name, Raghu, the devotee who has farms in India. What's his name? Raghu something.
Bhakti Raghava
Maharaj, yeah. He reprinted Hare Krishna Dasi's book that was first published about 30 years ago, which was supposed to be one in five volumes. She only published one volume. But that one volume has a lot in it, and you can read it. But Bhakti Raghava Swami reprinted the book And it's now again circulating through his different agencies.
I understand, Guru Maharaj, that it is imperative for us now to establish farm communities. It's an urgent need now, but we really must do it right from get-go. Otherwise, we have, you know, the situation where we are going with our begging bowl back to the donors saying, please give us money for cow protection. Please give us money to pay the bills for the temple power and electricity. Please give us
And there is a way to do it. And there's also a training program that needs to be implemented in order to acclimatize devotees to live in that environment and work in that environment. And we also suggest that not everyone goes to the farms, because for some people, they'll never be able to maintain themselves. They're too much city oriented. For those devotees, they can spend time at the farms, but there's others. And Prabhupada said, mostly the farms are for the grihasthas. He said the brahmacharis and sannyasis should travel. They can come and live at the farms at different times, but they should be traveling and preaching in the cities. And the community, the farm communities should be run by the grihasthas. Families. If you want to investigate a little bit more, find what they're doing at Gita Nagari. Prem Kishori, she was on the chat yesterday. She has a lot of knowledge in these categories. How when she took her two children to the farm, boy, the kids just loved it there. They were just feeling so happy. You have to understand this city life, as it increasingly gets more and more, what we say, in the same direction is going, is not for civilized people, it's for animals. It's unhealthy, it's dangerous. And it's based on economic development. There are nice cities. City life is also part of Vedic culture, but not the kind of cities we have. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm. Guru Maharaj, Diptesh Prabhu has a question. He has raised his hand.
Okay. Diptesh.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to you, Maharaj.
I can see you on a farm with a pair of overalls and a shovel. Boy, you look really good.
We do have farmlands in India, but somebody else does it for us. And that was my question, Maharaj, that we know that we are going in the wrong direction. We know the importance of simple living and Krishna conscious thinking. We have been hit by a practical example at the moment as well. I want to understand you from you, Maharaj, from your experience in dealing with devotees, the complexities, but also the what stops a devotee to fully commit to this type of lifestyle. For me,
attachment to all the conveniences that modern lifestyle gives. You know, you just push your button or your lights on, push a button and you got music. You push a button, you know, your cooking stove starts. We're all pushing buttons, that's all. It's so convenient. We're just accustomed to this convenience. And as Sri Devi brought out, there has been some failures. And so the failures sort of also kind of disillusion people in this direction. But there is a way to do it. And like I said, it's not for everybody. But everyone can spend time in this lifestyle, but there are people who will eventually have to live there and maintain all these farms. When it takes a while to get these things going. You're not going to develop a project like this in 1 or 2 years. It's going to take minimum 5 years to get it off the ground. Just where it starts to show signs of viability. Nobody wants to take the time. And not nobody, but not enough people want to take the time.
So it's our attachment to get things done quickly as we are accustomed to in these modern cities. And
yeah,
that helps us.
I'm also like that. I lived in New Vrindavan for 20 years. I was there for 20 years. But I wasn't doing farm work. I was doing some farm work, but not as a service. I was doing mostly pujari work, cooking, pujari work, like that. But I lived on a farm from 1973 to around 1993, with a few years in between that I traveled out. But well, most of that 20 years I was in New Vrindavan. But, you know, I'm not on the farm now. I left the farm program in 1993, 94, and I started to travel and preach. And I've been doing that ever since. But I can see both the benefits from different angles of vision and how this lifestyle that we are presently, you know, amidst in is not going to really bring any happiness or culture or even good health. And the cities are hell. They're just hell. There's so much noise, so much pollution, crime. The food you get is just third class at best. The thing is, we may not be able to do much in our life, but then again, we have to look to the future generations for establishing Krishna consciousness. We will still have our preaching centers in the cities. That'll still go on. But our lifestyle will be focused on a more simplified way, which is more healthier and more conducive to practicing Krishna consciousness. Sometimes people think when you get on the farm, you have to work hard. There might be some work once in the initially getting things going. But once there is a community effort and devotees are somewhat adept at knowing what to do, then you'll find that each individual has more and more time for their personal activities. It can't be done by what with one family, two families. It has to be a community where there are many families together. And then you can set up a school for the kids. I posted something today on, I don't know if you've seen it. Did anybody see what I posted about the NASA report on children? Did anybody see that? Yeah, Yeah, can somebody read that?
Yes, Guru Maharaj, I can read. The topic was today's educational systems. NASA did a research which showed that 98% of all children of the age of 4 to 5 years are geniuses. But after attending schools and colleges, the percentage dropped to 2%. Confirms what Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur has said. Modern education slaughters the good qualities of everyone.
Yeah, so this coming from the secular world, they show that education destroys, you know, the character, qualities, and abilities, and intelligence. So that we want to, you know, expose our children to these kind of environments. Kids are smart today because they know how to use computers, that's all. they're all IT whizzes, you know. But that's not intelligence. Intelligence is not how to work a computer or work any kind of technological device. Intelligence is to discriminate between what is right and what is wrong.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and to you. I was just going to point out, what would someone like myself, who's had a physical problem for so many years, to try to go to a farm community? I think, I don't know that I could do that kind of work at all. Would teaching, or I don't know what I would do as service.
You are a teacher, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so you could continue your occupation by educating children or anybody who wants that education. That could be done in that environment also. You wouldn't have to travel to do it. Everything could be right there. And because, I mean, you're not so young, I'm not saying you're old, but you're not so young, so it's not like you have to go out and work hard, and that's not for everybody who lives in that environment. See, this is where we get into the wrong mindset. We think, oh, farm work, oh my God, so hard work.
I would love to do it. If I could, you know, I would love to, but my body won't allow it.
No, so just you do what you can. No one is forced to do something that they will be detrimental to their health. Yeah, you could teach. You're a language teacher, right?
Yes.
Well, that's always an interest, teaching languages. That's if you like to do it.
Yes. Yes, Guru Maharaj. Well, yeah, absolutely.
We also have secular education as part of the schools that we want to develop for our children, along with spiritual education, too.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
You like the cows too, right?
Of course, I love the cows. Yes.
I could tell you a fact, and this is going on in the secular world. When people have mental disturbances, there is a small group of people who understand the benefit of the cow. So they let people come to farms to associate with the cows. And by doing that, this decreases their mental disturbances. When you spend time with cows, your anxieties, your stress, all of that stuff goes automatically. That's another benefit of the cow that we know of, but the secular world is just starting to find out. Only a small part of the secular world start to realize that cows actually make you peaceful.
We need that in the States right now, very much so, because of the, I feel the fall of democracy has happened, you know, and our so-called democracy has just occurred. I mean, I try not to be affected. I haven't been affected most of the time during this pandemic, but with this storming of the Capitol Hill, it really was symbolic of what Prabhupada said, that this system is going to collapse, because that was the symbol of democracy. And I cried out of sadness. It's going to happen now. I see it.
Yeah, it's happening, and it'll continue even after the new president gets in there. It's not going to stop just because the time is up. It'll continue. And because people are lost, they're so dissatisfied, and they take to the violence as an outlet. And they justify that as a way to bring about improvement. This is another form of sick mentality.
Yes.
And some people look forward to that because by nature they like this kind of conflict. Yeah, and so we are in a very, what we say, what's the word? Time where we have to decide what direction we want to go in life. Even at this elderly age, we are sometimes now being kind of like forced to make changes in our life and maybe redirect our energies in a more beneficial way. Okay, so maybe we can stop here. We'll continue the discussion.
Guru Maharaj, there is one question from Mohanasini Radha Mataji. Can we take that?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna Gurudev, do we create bad karma if we are not engaged in Ahimsa farm communities and just live simple life in a small town? Go to work and serve in our temple irregularly.
Karma is bad, good and bad karma is done by material activities. For a devotee, they're not under the influence of karma because they're engaged in devotional service. So you choose your lifestyle that is conducive to your support of your spiritual life. That's the basic. You want to live in such a way is that it makes spiritual life successful or easier and more natural. So whether you live this way or that way, your karma is something that comes by way of material activities. If you act materially and you're a devotee, Krishna will slap you with a little bit of a reaction, but you're not getting karma. You're getting Krishna's special mercy in the form of a slap, just to wake you up, to show you, hey, you're a devotee, you're acting in the wrong way. Don't act like the karmis. So one who takes the devotional service, they're not under the influence of karma anymore, but they still can act in the wrong way, and that brings Krishna's mercy in the form of the corrective force. It's not karma. Okay. Thank you, Mother Archana City, for hosting us today.
Thank you so much, Guru Maharaj. It was a wonderful talk today. Thank you so much.
We'll continue with the subject, and we'll continue with the same verse tomorrow, and we'll expand on this topic a little bit more in different areas. Okay, all glories to His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada.
Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Guru Maharaj ki jai. All glories to Assembled. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj, for another wonderful lecture. We are so grateful.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you for a beautiful class. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Thank you.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol, Vivek.
Maharaj, Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol.
Thank you, Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Lakshmi.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much, Gurudev.
Hare Vivek, Anjali.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj.
Pranava.
Raghavendra.